As a special case, we are going to study reflection of normal incidence due to perfect dielectric medium. So assuming that region 1 and region 2 are perfect dielectric medium, in this case, epsilon 1 double dashes and epsilon 2 double dashes are 0. Or in other words, we have the attenuation coefficients equal 0. And the intrinsic impedance eta 1 and eta 2 are both real and positive values. So in this case, the reflection coefficient gamma would be eta 2 minus eta 1 over eta 2 plus eta 1. As I said before, if eta 2 is greater than eta 1, the phase shift would be 0. If eta 2 is less than eta 1, the phase shift would be pi. And actually, if region 1 is free space and region 2 is any dielectric media, so any dielectric media has epsilon r is greater than unit. And effectively, eta equal mu over square root of mu over r. So if I'm going from free space to any dielectric media, so the reflection coefficient would have a phase shift by in this case. Alright? So keeping this in your mind. And the transmission coefficient, it would be 1 plus gamma. Gamma as it is. If it is positive, it would be positive. If it is negative, it would be negative. And it equals 2 multiplied by eta 2 over eta 1 plus eta 2. And in this case, the value of tau, if I'm going from free space to a dielectric media, tau it would be less than unit. Okay. As an example, assuming that we have medium 1 has a characteristic impedance or intrinsic impedance 100 ohms, and eta 2 and medium 2 has intrinsic impedance 300 ohms, and the incident electric field it was 100 volt per meter, and it is required to find out the electric field and magnetic field and the pointing vector and or power density in region 1 for the incident reflected and in region 2 for the transmitted. So in this case, the reflection coefficient gamma would equal eta 2 minus eta 1 over eta 2 plus eta 1. So it is 300 minus 100 over 300 plus 100, so the reflection coefficient would be half with phase shift equal 0. So the reflected electric field would be gamma multiplied by the incident electric field. So the magnitude of the reflected field would be gamma multiplied by 100, would be 50 volt per meter. In a similar way, we can say that the transmission coefficient term is 1 plus gamma. So it is 1 plus 0.5 is 1.5. So the magnitude of the transmitted electric field would be tau multiplied by the incident electric field. So it is 1.5 multiplied by 100. It is 150 volt per meter. Don't worry that the magnitude of the transmitted electric field is greater than the incident electric field. Don't worry about this. Why? Because we are not talking about electric field only. We are talking about electric field and magnetic field. And effectively, we are interested or we are talking about the power density. So, actually, the reflected power density and the transmitted power density, each one of them should be less than or equal the incident power density. It cannot exceed the value of the incident power density. But the value of the electric field only, as the electric field, it can be greater than the incident electric field. Why? Because in this medium, for example, we will find out the intrinsic impedance will reduce the magnetic field by a very large amount. So We have increased the electric field, but we reduced the magnetic field. So the multiplication of the electric field by the magnetic field in medium 2, it would be less than the incident power density. Okay? So don't worry about this. But effectively, in the case of the reflected field, the amplitude of the reflected field, it must be less than or equal to the incident field. Why? Because the reflected field in the same region of the incident field. So the relation between the magnetic field of the reflected field is the same relation between the magnetic field of the incident field to the incident electric field. So in this case, to obtain reflected power density less than the incident power density, the electric field of the reflected field as an amplitude, it must be less than or equal the incident field. So once again, I repeat, the amplitude of the transmitted electric field, it can be greater than the amplitude of the incident field. But the amplitude of the reflected field cannot be greater than the amplitude of the incident field. Alright? Okay. This is the electric field. Now, to obtain the magnetic fields, the magnetic field of the incident field, Hy plus, it would be the magnitude of the incident electric field over eta 1. So, it is 100 volt per meter over eta 1, 100 ohms. So, the magnitude of the magnetic field in this case is 1 ampere per meter. Now, the amplitude of the reflected magnetic field, first of all, it would be in the negative sign because the propagation would be in the negative z direction instead of positive z direction. The magnitude of the electric field of the reflected field, 50, over the intrinsic impedance of medium 1, so 50 over 100, would be minus 0.5 ampere per meter. Now, the amplitude of the magnetic field of the transmitted field would be the amplitude of the transmitted field, 150, over the intrinsic impedance of medium 2, 300. So 150 over 300 is 0.5 ampere per meter. Now, let us calculate the power density of the incident field. The power density of the incident field would be 1 over 2, the magnitude of the electric field squared over eta 1. So, or in other words, half real the magnitude of the electric field cross product the magnetic field conjugate. So, in this case, it would be half 100 multiplied by 1. So, it is 50 watt per meter squared. So, this is the incident power density. Now, the reflected power density is half the amplitude of the electric field multiplied by the magnetic field. So, it is 50 multiplied by 0.5. So, over 2, it is 12.5 watt per meter square. Okay? And its direction in the negative direction. The transmitted power density would be half the amplitude of the transmitted electric field multiplied by the transmitted magnetic field, would be half 150 multiplied by 0.5, so it is 37.5 watt per meter square. It is quite clear that even so, the magnitude of the electric field in medium 2 is greater than the incident field, the transmitted power in medium 2 is less than the incident power. Why? Because here the magnetic field has been damped by greater intrinsic impedance. So the value of the magnetic field is damped. Here, the value of the magnetic field was the electric field over 100. Here, the value of the magnetic field is the electric field over 300. So the power density or transmitted power density is 37.5 watt per meter square. To check the correctness of our solution, the energy should be conservative. So the reflected power density plus the transmitted power density should equal the incident power density. So if we sum the reflected power density and the transmitted power density, we will find it would be 50 watt per meter. So the power density or the pointing vector of the incident field equal the pointing vector of the reflected field plus the pointing vector of the transmitted field. Okay. Sometimes for dielectric material which doesn't have magnetic properties, everything is related to the square root of the relative permittivity. So we are going to define the square root of the relative permittivity, square root of epsilon r, as the reflective index of the medium. So if I'm talking about perfect dielectric material which has epsilon double dash equal 0, and it is non-magnetic material, so mu r equal 1, so the propagation constant beta would equal omega square root mu naught epsilon naught epsilon r. So we can separate this epsilon r, so we can say that it is omega square root mu naught epsilon naught, which is k naught or omega over c, multiplied by the square root of epsilon r, or in other words, multiplied by n, the reflective index of this medium. So beta equals n k naught. Eta, the characteristic impedance, would be square root mu over epsilon, would be square root mu naught over epsilon naught over epsilon r. So we can say that square root of mu naught over epsilon naught, which is eta naught, over n. So the intrinsic impedance in the case of perfect dielectric media can be represented as the intrinsic impedance of free space over the refractive index of the medium n. The phase velocity it was 1 over square root mu epsilon, so it is mu naught epsilon naught mu epsilon r. 1 over mu naught epsilon naught is c, the speed of light in free space, over square root of epsilon r over n. So the phase velocity in this case, it would be the speed of light in free space over the refractive index n. In a similar way, the wavelength lambda would be the phase velocity over the frequency, so it would be c over the frequency over n. C over n is the free space wavelength. So the wavelength inside the dielectric media can be represented as the free space wavelength lambda naught over the refractive index of the medium. So effectively, in the case of perfect dielectric media, we can generalize the value of propagation constant, the value of intrinsic impedance, the value of phase velocity, the value of the wavelength in terms of these values in free space with respect to the reflective index of the media, which is the square root of the permittivity of this material. Okay, usually the concept of the reflective index is used in optics. So most people for optics are using n instead of square root of epsilon r, but both of them are equivalent to each other. Okay? Alright.